Hello students, today we are going to discuss chapter 3 of class 11 business studies, that is public, private and global enterprises. The industrial policy resolutions of 1948 and 1956 assigned dominant role to the state in the spheres of industrial, commercial and public utility activities before 1991. The private sector was always restricted from entering certain areas of business by a number of barriers such as licensing, reserving too many areas for public sector and small scale industries. India had adopted mixed economy. Role of private sector is complementary to public sector. New industrial policy 1991 opened unlimited opportunities for growth in private sector. Thus, now we have public sector, private sector and global enterprises. Now we come to the rationale of public sector. Why is public sector so important? Immediately after independence, India had to go in for rapid economic and social development to overcome the problems of poverty, unemployment, illiteracy, health and imbalance in regional economic growth. The rationale of initiating public sector enterprises to rebuild the Indian economy and socially are, first of all, defense requirements. Strategic supplies of goods for defense can't be left to the whims of private sector. Basic and heavy industries. The private sector may not venture to establish basic and heavy industries requiring huge capital outlay and longer gestation period. Now let us discuss what is gestation period. Gestation period is the time period between the amount invested and the result achieved. Third rationale is public utilities. Since the private sector is motivated with earning profits, the public utility services like water supply, electricity, gas, etc., where ready profit opportunities do not exist, may not be touched by the private sector. Therefore, the state has to assume the responsibility for public welfare. Next rationale is preventing concentration of economic power and monopolies. To prevent concentration of economic power and monopolies, which may lead to inequalities in distribution of wealth and resources, takeover of private industrial enterprises by the state is prompted. Next important rationale is infrastructure. Infrastructure comprising transport, communication, irrigation, etc. can be developed by state only, as they demand long gestation period and lesser return on investment. Development of backward regions. For balanced development of all regions, government is justified in locating new enterprises in backward areas. Next rationale is financing economic development and employment. The state can mobilize resources to finance development and employment programs out of surpluses generated in working of its enterprises. What does this mean? It means some profit earning enterprises are utilized, that is, the return from those enterprises are utilized to invest elsewhere where employment opportunities can be generated. Next rationale is socialist pattern of society. India adopted socialism to follow a policy of enlarging public sector in all crucial spheres to tighten its hold over economy and accomplish objectives of faster growth with social justice. Now let us understand what is private sector. Private sector means enterprises owned and controlled by private businessmen. Their main motive is profit. Example, Tata Company, Reliance Industry, Wipro Limited. And then what is public sector? Public sector enterprises are those enterprises which are partially and wholly owned by central or state government. Main motive of public sector is public or social interest. That is, they want to work for general public welfare as well as earn profit. Example of such type of enterprises are GAIL, Gas Authority of India, SAIL, Steel Authority of India. Now, we are going to discuss the various forms of public enterprises working in our country. The oldest and the most important among them is departmental undertaking. These undertakings are controlled by the ministry. They are financed by the government and all the important decisions are taken by the concerned ministry. Obviously, since they are in full control of the government, all the earnings of these departments are deposited in government treasury. Where are they suitable? They are most suitable for activities of vital importance such as defense, telecommunication, power, etc. For operations of public utilities, example, post and telegraph, and for contribution to government revenue, example, Indian Railways. The features of these departmental undertakings are, they do not have any separate entity because they are under the central or state government control. Obviously, their management and control by the ministry, and they have to obey all the decisions taken by the ministry. Therefore, they do not have any financial autonomy. That is, funding from government treasury and revenue is paid into the treasury. Whatever finance comes to them comes from the government, and their earnings definitely go to the government treasury. Now, since they are fully owned by the ministry concerned, the financing is from the government, obviously the decision making will also be from the government. There is no flexibility in decision making. Auditing and accounting control, as applicable to government activities, similarly, like other government departments, all the auditing and accounting controls are with the government, and the management is under the direct control of the ministry. The employees are government or civil servants. Being a government department, naturally, its employees have to be the government employees. Now, what are the merits of such type of an organization? The most important advantage of these departmental undertakings is effective control by parliament. Since they are under the control of direct ministry, the parliament is taking the full charge of the department, and without the permission of the government, they cannot go further. There is high degree of public accountability, as obviously these departments belong to the government and the government belongs to the public. Since the government is answerable to the public, obviously these departments also owe a high degree of accountability towards the public and the government. Next advantage is increase in government income. Since revenue earned by these organizations goes directly to the treasury of the government, they add to the government income. These are most suitable for those organizations where national security. These departmental undertakings are most vital for national security, as it is under direct control and supervision of ministry. Since they are so advantageous, there must be some limitations also. After all, nobody is perfect. The limitations of departmental undertakings are, obviously, they are inflexible. Since they are under the tight control of the government, they do not have any flexibility, whereas flexibility is essential for smooth operation of business. Lack of prompt action. Employees are not allowed to take independent decisions. Bureaucracy. There may be various business opportunities arising in the environment, but these enterprises are not able to take advantage of those opportunities because the bureaucrats are conservative. They do not easily permit for quick changes in the way of working. Next limitation is red tapeism. No action can be taken unless it goes through proper channels of authority. Next limitation is political interference. Since these departments are under the tight control of the ministry, there is regular political interference in these organizations. As and when there is a change in the government, the next government comes up with its own policies and interferes in the smooth working of these ministries. Absence of competition. These organizations are usually insensitive to consumer needs and do not provide adequate services. Next organization of public enterprise is statutory corporation. Statutory corporation is a body corporate formed by special act of parliament. Act defines its powers and functions and has capacity to act in its name. That is, these corporations are brought into existence by a special act of parliament. Their limitations, their boundaries of working, their powers, their functions are all defined in that particular act. But they are an individual legal entity and they can act in their own name. That is, they can sue and be sued in their own name. They are a separate legal entity. Initial capital is introduced in these statutory corporations by the government, but they can also raise loans from public in the form of bonds. Now, where are statutory corporations most suitable? When huge capital is required, naturally a single businessman or even private enterprises cannot accumulate so much capital to be able to compete with statutory corporations established by government. The enterprises to run on business lines and for public interest. Various statutory corporations are Industrial Finance Corporation of India, IFCI, Life Insurance Corporation of India, LIC. Now, what are the features of these corporations? They are formed under Act of Parliament. They have a separate legal existence, body corporate, can sue and be sued in its own name. Ownership of these organizations is of the government, that is, they belong to the government. They are economically dependent both on government as well as private sources. The appointment of the employees of these organizations can be from private organizations as well. They have autonomy, that is, they obtain funds by borrowing from government or public. Now, what are the merits of statutory corporation? The most important advantage of statutory corporation is that they have autonomy in operations, that is, they are free from undesirable government regulation and control. It is because of this advantage that they are able to take quick decisions. Since they do belong to the public sector enterprise, their main motive is also service. They want to do welfare for the society as well as earn enough profit to give government treasury a boost. They are professionally managed, that is, there are professionals and government employees as well as private sector employees who manage the organization. There is efficiency of staff. Since private organizations are also deployed to acquire employees, staff apts to be quite efficient. Economic development. They have the power of government combined with the initiative of private sector. This leads to economic development of the country. Despite so many advantages of public corporation, they do have a few limitations. First is incomplete operation autonomy. Actually, in reality, they are not so free from government clutches. That is, all their actions are subject to many rules and regulations. There is regular political interference and major decisions where huge funds are involved are taken by the government. There is monopoly. Government has a practice of appointing advisors to the corporation board. That is, the government does not freely leave these organizations to independently do whatever they want to. They are public enterprises and government keeps a watch on their activities as well as the advisors give regular guidance to the corporation regarding their regular day-to-day working. This curbs the freedom of the corporation in entering into contracts. The last important public enterprise are government companies. According to Companies Act 1956, government companies means at least 51% of paid up capital with central or state or jointly by both. Dear friends, in this session, we have discussed public enterprises, why they are so important in our society, what is the rationale of having public enterprises in our society, why are they so advantageous for our society. Then we discussed the various forms of public enterprises, and we have discussed first two major forms of public enterprises, that is departmental undertaking and public corporation. Next session will be on government companies, in which we will discuss in detail how government companies operate, what are the advantages and disadvantages, as well as where are the most suitable. Thank you.